Hey, welcome to Non-Standard Models, where we venture to the frontier of theoretical physics. Today, I'm here with Valentina Forini.
Hello.
And Maria Kallimani.
Hello.
Valentina is a professor in theoretical physics at Humboldt University in Berlin, and she's also been my PhD supervisor. And Maria is a PhD student working in the group of Professor Holm. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for inviting us.
Today, Valentina and Maria are here to tell us about a topic that is actually quite dear to me, since it is related to the work I did during my PhD. We are talking about holography. Probably all of you at some point have seen a hologram. For example, looking at banknotes or credit cards, you see these little tiny shiny patches. And if we twist the card, suddenly a three-dimensional image pops out of a two-dimensional plane. In theoretical physics, when we say holography, we mean the study of how a theory with gravity in higher dimension is encoded in a theory without gravity in lower dimensions. Maria, could you tell us how this idea originated?
Sure, so this idea originated in the context of black holes. So black holes are these objects in our universe that are super mysterious and fascinating. They are essentially these regions of space-time in which nothing can escape, not even light. And we don't know too much about them. There are many questions to answer. One, for example, is what happens to an object when it falls in a black hole? Do we lose all information about that object? So one possibility is that this information is actually still living in the surface of the black hole. So yeah, this is what essentially holography is. We have a region that is dominated by gravity, and instead of describing it through its entire volume, we can just use its surface.
But nowadays, this idea is not only applied in the context of black holes, right, Valentina?
Yeah, that's right. This idea of holography is at the basis of a really radically new tool, a potentially powerful tool to understand better nature. We know that the standard model of particle physics is not complete in many ways, actually. It only describes three out of the four fundamental forces, the electromagnetism, the strong, and the weak force. We don't know how to include gravity in this picture, but here it's where holography comes into play, allowing us to connect the building blocks of the standard model, what we call gauge theories, to quantum theories of gravity in higher dimensions. And we call it gauge gravity duality. And for it, we have a dictionary. It's, in lay terms, a little bit like when you go for a trip to an exotic country and you install a translator on your phone to understand the foreign language, the language of quantum gravities, in terms of your native language, language of gauge theory. Of course, you can use this translator also in a reverse way.
Indeed, this holographic framework is really central in modern theoretical physics, and it's pretty versatile. The most famous example of such a duality is the ADS-CFT correspondence, which has just celebrated its 26th birthday. So what are gauge theories? How do we use holography to understand gravity? And what does the ADS-CFT correspondence mean? Let's find out. All right, let's dive into this gauge and gravity duality, and let's start from the gauge side. Physicists have tried to describe nature for over a century through gauge theories. Both matter and the fundamental forces can be described using mathematical objects called fields that take numerical values at every point of spacetime. This value of the fields can fluctuate, and the fluctuations are called particles. They are localized and they propagate in spacetime. Moreover, particles are also the mediators of the fundamental forces. For example, think about a photon, which is the mediator of the electromagnetic force, and it's also the fluctuation of the electromagnetic field. But Valentina, we said that gauge theories are really the pillars of our modern understanding of nature. But what is so special about them?
Gauge theories describe interaction between those kind of fields that you mentioned, and they do that with the help of a symmetry, which is called gauge symmetry. Usually, when we talk about symmetries, we mean transformations which leave a physical system unchanged and that act at each point of space-time in the same way. Gauge symmetries, on the contrary, act at each point of the space-time in a different way. Think about this analogy. Imagine a room which is illuminated by different lamps and, of course, different light switches are there. Now, having a gauge symmetry means being able to flip those light switches in different parts of the room without changing the overall brightness of the room.
Yeah, that's neat. It's a nice way to think about it, but still it sounds pretty challenging. So if we want to make predictions using this series, we should develop a variety of different tools to tackle them. One of the mostly used is perturbation theory. But what is perturbation theory, Maria, and how we can use it to describe the interactions between particles?
So perturbation theory relies on the fact that gauge theories have this indicator built in them, which is the gauge coupling. And the value of this quantity indicates how strong or how weak the interactions are, meaning how often particles interact with each other. And this means that when the coupling is strong, particles interact with each other more frequently, and when it's weak, they interact less frequently. So what happens when we have weak coupling is that we can use perturbation theory, just focus on the main interaction that happens most often, and then add the subsequent ones as like small corrections to that, which is what we call perturbations. This is a quite natural way of thinking if you think about it, because like if I wanted to draw a tree, for example, I would just draw a rectangular trunk, and then on top of it, I would put a green blob. And still, you could tell me, yes, this is a tree. But if I wanted a more realistic picture, I would add leaves, I would add branches, I would make it much more close to reality. And in physics, this is what we want. We want to get close to reality and get more precise results. So if we focus on the main interaction, we might be getting something approximately true, but to get closer to what is happening, we add the small perturbations.
I really like this analogy because we actually use drawings in perturbation theory. They are called Feynman diagrams, and they are really useful because they translate these complicated interactions within particles in a more effective graphical language. Unfortunately, they are increasingly complex as we add more and more interactions, and for every interaction, there is an infinite number of possible diagrams. But Valentina, can we learn something from these diagrams without computing them all?
Yes. So about 50 years ago, theoreticians were developing a gauge theory for strong interactions, what is called quantum chromodynamics. In particular, Gerard Toft was studying, let's say, a cousin of this theory when he noticed that perturbation theory becomes significantly simpler in a certain limit, which is the limit in which only a certain kind of diagrams are important, those which can be drawn on a plane.
Right, so Toft's result was indeed really useful, but when he included back the non-planar diagrams, he derived something more astonishing, right, Valentina?
Right. What Toft noticed is that considering together planar and non-planar diagrams, there is a one-to-one correspondence between those diagrams and surfaces with an increasing number of holes. So a planar diagram would correspond to a sphere, and non-planar diagram, a first kind of, would correspond to a sphere with a hole, what has the shape of a donut and mathematically is called the torus. And then a second non-planar diagram would correspond to a sphere with two holes, so a two torus, and so on. But what is even more remarkable is that if you now take a closed string, which is a small loop, and consider its interactions with other closed strings in space-time, and draw the Feynman diagrams which correspond to these interactions, you will find the very same surfaces.
Yeah, that must have been quite mind-blowing for physicists back then to realize that there is a connection between gauge theories and string theory. Years later, this came to be known as gauge-gravity duality. Maria, can you give us an idea of how string theory originated and how is it connected to gravity?
So in the 70s, people were trying to model the strong force, and in the end, this was very successful through quantum chromodynamics, but back then, one of the most promising candidates for that was string theory. It was soon realized that it didn't quite work out, however, it was not forgotten by physicists, who in the future realized that string theory offers a very natural way to describe gravity in very small scales. So how does that happen? In string theory, our objects are these closed loops, which we call closed strings, and these strings, they vibrate. Each one of their vibrations, in fact, corresponds to a propagating particle. So the higher the frequency of this vibration, meaning the faster that the string vibrates, the higher the energy of this propagating particle, and in fact, the higher its mass. So what turns out to be true is that one of these vibrations is the graviton, a hypothetical particle that mediates the gravitational force. So, in fact, in this way, string theory offers a very promising way to describe gravity in the quantum realm. However, string theory, in the form it's commonly used in, does not correspond to our universe in 3+1 dimensions, but the strings live in a 10-dimensional space-time.
Okay, so coming back to Toft, he established that there is a connection between gauge theories and string theory, which encodes gravity, and he used Feynman diagrams as a hint. The most famous example of such a duality is the so-called ADS CFT correspondence, which was conjectured by Juan Malacena in 1997. Perhaps we could use this case to illustrate how this is related to holography and why this is such an important tool for physicists. But first, let's introduce the main players, Maria.
Sure. So on the one side, we have ADS, which stands for anti-de Sitter. And this is a special kind of space-time, which has a constant negative curvature in, say, hyperbolic space-time. It is a solution to Einstein's equations of general relativity. Hence, it is the universe where there is gravity and where the strings that we talked about before live. On the other side, we have CFT, which stands for conformal field theory. And these are special cases of quantum field theories, which have a special symmetry called conformal symmetry, which preserves angles but not distances. And the gauge theories that we care about when we work in holography are indeed conformal field theories. So these theories have this special feature, which is scale invariance. And what this means is that we can zoom in or out in space-time and still see the same laws of physics. Equivalently, we can look at the theory at different energy scales, and still we have the same physics in all of these scales.
Okay, so now that we have introduced the main ingredients of this correspondence, let's analyze the nature, the holographic nature of it. Valentina.
Yes, so at the beginning, we said that holography relates theories in different dimensions. And that's exactly what's going on here. The anti-de Sitter space, which is the space where strings live, has one dimension more with respect to the space where the conformal field theory of gauge fields live. More precisely, the conformal gauge theory sits at the boundary of this anti-de Sitter space. And then what the correspondence implies is highly non-trivial. It implies that the information which is necessary to describe strings and so quantum gravity in this higher dimensional space should be reshuffled and recombined to describe a conformal theory of gauge fields in this lower dimensional space.
So we can have insights on one theory just by looking at the other and vice versa, and that's why this duality is such a powerful tool. Right, Valentina?
Exactly. It's really powerful precisely because of its nature of weak, strong duality. So when the theory is weakly coupled, as we said before, we can use perturbation theory to describe interactions between particles. We said that it's like adding details to the drawing of a tree. However, suppose that now you don't want to consider these individual trees, but the entire forest. The more the trees interact, the harder will be to study this ecosystem. And that's very similar to what happens when studying strongly coupled particles. The more they interact, the harder it is to make computations. The ADS-CFT correspondence connects the weak and strong coupling regimes of the two theories. When the gauge theory is strongly coupled, string theory is weakly coupled, and vice versa. So that hard computation on one side becomes approachable, so easier, on the other side, and vice versa.
So not only the ADS-CFT correspondence provide a useful tool for computations, but it also connects gravity and gauge theories in an unexpected way. However, in its current state, it is still a conjecture. So Maria, is there any way to prove it?
Indeed, for the past 20 years, physicists have been trying to come up with proofs or at least consistency checks for ADS-CFT. However, for now, we do have some highly non-trivial checks, but substantial evidence exists only for lower dimensional theories. So in fact, we're very far from proving ADS-CFT. However, something like that would require a deeper understanding of quantum gravity, perhaps even new sorts of mathematical tools. In fact, in my PhD project, I am going to try to contribute to a mathematical formulation of this conjecture by using some mathematical tools like homotopy algebras.
That's really interesting. So indeed, like, holography can be a field where mathematics and physics meet in a fruitful and fascinating way. So besides the mathematical proof of the idiocy of the dictionary, what are the open problems that physicists are trying to solve right now, Valentina?
So the list of problems is very long. Both technical and conceptual questions are on the plate. Remember, on the field theory side, we have this coupling constant that one can tune from weak to strong. A part of the community has been working and is still working on how to evaluate exactly this path at each value of the coupling constant, using both mathematical and so analytical tools and numerical tools, and using, of course, information from the string theory side. I also work on this, in particular on understanding how to calculate efficiently quantum effects of strings in anti-de Sitter. But holographic methods can be used in a much wider variety of contexts, which range from solid-state physics. For example, we can learn more through holography about superconductivity, to cosmology. So certain special systems in condensed matter can be used to improve our understanding of black holes.
This is very exciting. We have seen how the holographic principles tie together gravity and particles in an unexpected yet fascinating way through string theory. And we also mentioned an example of such a duality, which is the idiocy of the correspondence. Without a doubt, the idea of holography gave us already great insights into both gauge theories and gravity, and due to its wealth of application, it will be at the forefront of research for the years to come. Thank you, Valentina and Maria, for the correspondence.
And thank you very much for having us, Giulia.
And thank you for watching. See you next time here on Non-Standard Models.